A Child of the Jago by Arthur Morrison. Read by Nicholas Boulton for Naxos Audiobooks. Woe unto the foolish prophets that follow their own spirit and have seen nothing, because, even because, they have seduced my people, saying, Peace, and there was no peace. And one built up a wall, and lo, others daubed it with untempered mortar. Say unto them which daub it with untempered mortar, that it shall fall. There shall be an overflowing shower, and ye, O great hailstones, shall fall, and a stormy wind shall rend it. Lo, when the wall is fallen, shall it not be said unto you, Where is the daubing wherewith ye have daubed it? Ezekiel 13, verses 3 and 10 to 12. Chapter 1. It was past the mid of a summer night in the old Jago. The narrow street was all the blacker for the lurid sky, for there was a fire in a farther part of Shoreditch, and the welkin was an infernal coppery glare. Below, the hot, heavy air lay, a rank oppression, on the contorted forms of those who made for sleep on the pavement, and in it, and through it all, there rose from the foul earth and the grimed walls a close, mingled stink, the odour of the Jago. From where off Shoreditch High Street, a narrow passage, set across with posts, gave menacing entrance on one end of Old Jago Street, to where the other end lost itself in the black beyond Jago Row, from where Jago Row began south at Meakin Street, to where it ended north at Honey Lane. There, the Jago, for 100 years the blackest pit in London, lay and festered. And halfway along Old Jago Street, a narrow archway gave upon Jago Court, the blackest hole in all that pit. A square of 250 yards or less, that was all there was of the Jago. But in that square, the human population swarmed in thousands. Old Jago Street, New Jago Street, Half Jago Street lay parallel east and west. Jago Row at one end, and Edge Lane at the other, lay parallel also, stretching north and south. Foul ways all. What was too vile for Kate Street, Seven Dials, and Ratcliffe Highway in its worst day, what was too useless, incapable, and corrupt, all that teemed in the old Jago. Old Jago Street lay black and close under the quivering red sky, and slinking forms as of great rats followed one another quickly between the posts in the gut by the high street and scattered over the Jago. For the crowd about the fire was now small. The police was there in force, and every safe pocket had been tried. Soon the incursion ceased, and the sky, flickering and brightening no longer, settled to a sullen flush. On the pavement, some writhed wearily, longing for sleep. Others, despairing of it, sat and lolled, and a few talked. They were not there for lack of shelter, but because in this weather repose was less unlikely in the street than within doors, and the lodgings of the few who nevertheless abode at home were marked here and there by the lights visible from the windows. For in this place none ever slept without a light, because of three kinds of vermin that light in some sort keeps at bay. Vermin which added to existence here a terror not to be guessed by the unafflicted, who object to being told of it. For on them that lay writhen and gasping on the pavement, on them that sat among them, on them that rolled and blasphemed in the lighted rooms, on every moving creature in this, the old Jago, day and night, sleeping and walking, the third plague of Egypt, and more, lay unceasing. The stifling air took a further oppression from the red sky. By the dark entrance to Jago Court, a man rose, flinging out an oath, and sat with his head bowed in his hands.
Ah, he said, I wish I was dead and kept a coffee shop.
He looked aside from his hands at his neighbours, but Kiddo Cook's ideal of heaven was no new thing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.